at the husband well, the flow, where you have a free surface that is in contact with the atmosphere. So that if you have something that is moving in an open channel, like a natural channel, so rivers, streams, or in an artificial channel like the waterways, the drainage channel, the irrigation channel, or even in where you have some structure where part of the section is occupied by water, like the seaways. Because if you see the seaways, you see that part of the entire structure is wet by water, and the other part is not in contact. Alright, to start this kind of problem, usually one uses the monodimensional theory, which means that you are following your flow only along one direction. Okay, so in this case, if you consider that your riverbed, for riverbed I mean this thing right here. So the shape of this thing right here is your riverbed. As if your riverbed is cylindrical, which means that the area of the riverbed depends only on the total depth of your water. Hence, this this dimension right here, which is the width of your riverbed, is not depending on the it's what is written about my head. A equal to A depending on epsilon depending on S, which means that each section depends only on the depth of the water and not on the position along your river. Alright? If it was like this, you had the second conditions. For example, here you have a section like this that is uniform in the first condition, that is the one that we are considering. In the other case, for example, you have a river, that is what happens in reality, that is going like this. So this, the total section of your river has a width that changes along the direction of the flow. Alright, so there are some things that we can consider our riverbed, as a cylindrical one. So basically, you have that this is the bottom line. This bottom line of the riverbed stands for the slope EF and is equal to the sin of this angle respect to the direction of the horizontal. Alright, so basically this is the bottom slope. And bottom slope is defined as EF. Okay, another assumption to study with the problem is that first we are considering that the fluid is incompressible, so the density again is constant. This EF that is represented right here, so it's this slope in this direction, is very slow. So usually you can approximate EF equals sin theta like the angle theta, which means that the cos theta is equal to 1. So, what does it turn out? It turns out that this section, the round section right here, the green section right there, so the vertical one, can be confused with the brown section. So, with the transversal section perpendicular to your flow. Another assumption that is made that is quite true is that your flow is turbulent almost all the time, which means that the Coriolis coefficient is equal to 1, and then that we have in front of us the linear cylindrical currents. We say that in the first lesson, when you have linear currents, this means that you have an hydrostatic pressure along its transversal section. So basically, combine two kinds of aspects. The first one is confusion, deception with the round one from the middle to the floor because the slope is not so strong, so it's a low value usually. And the other one is along this round section, you can assume that your current is linear, so along this section you have, along this section right here, you have an endostatic pressure. So basically, this endostatic pressure is written right there, it's zeta f plus epsilon. Zeta f is the pole respect to the reference system, again, so it's a geodetic point. Epsilon, why? How do you say this thing?
Why?
I say well. So why? Okay, here it's exactly the depth of the orbit. In fact, it's also reported in the cross section of the orbit, that is on your right side. Okay, so if this is true, can define what is called a specific anthem. Again, we have in front of us always Bernoulli. So Bernoulli plays all the role in almost all the role in fundamentals of equivalence, because basically here you have that the total specific head associated with the fluid is equal to what? To epsilon y, sorry, plus the cinetic term right here, 2 to the power of 2 over t, which means that you are considering the reference system along the bottom flow. So when you talk about the total specific end, you are considering the lowest point of each section, each cross section of the flow. Alright, so again some definition. Here you have, if you take this green section right there, you can prospective and see this section. So this little b is what is usually called the width of the virtual space. While b, which is exactly this part right here, is the wet perimeter. So it's the perimeter contact with flow. Okay, you can also express this law, these terms, in a graphical way. So, for example, if you fix the energy, you can represent Q over Y. So, sorry, it's counting before the reactor, but right here you have Q. And also right here you have so every time that you have a depth of the current inside closer, and you see again that if you fix Q, you can find the value of energy respect to the depth. So again, another definition of critical depth right here is when I fix Q, I obtain a new value of energy. So basically, first, why we are so interested to define and put that inside the current? Because usually when you try to solve this kind of problem, you will see that you have to compare two parameters. The first one is this, is the critical depth. The other one is what is called the uniform motion depth. So it's the depth associated with the uniform motion of the flow. So, and we will see that if one is greater or less than another, or lower than another, you can have the different kind of regions inside the uniform depth. So, here I wrote the definition of YC. So the first one is the one related to this diagram. So the first diagram is given E. There exists a value of depth YC which corresponds to a maximum value of Q. So basically, if I have a quantum moment where I know that Q is, E is even, so it's fixed and it doesn't change, because usually the energy changes if I have something that makes the perturbance of my flow. So, usually in this kind of problem, if I take constant the energy, I can define critical depth like the depth associated with the maximum value of the discharge. Alright. Then, in the same other way, in the other diagram here, we saw that there's also a relationship among energy and y. So basically, we can define a second definition for YC, which is even the discharge. YC is the value of depth which corresponds to the minimum value of specific energy. So this can be also demonstrated because following the first, I have dQ over dy, where the energy is constant. Remember that the energy gain is y plus Q to the power of 2 over 2g, A to the power of 2. So, is constant would mean that I have to express Q because I have to derive Q respect to Y. So from this, Q turns out to be A squared, it's 2G times E minus I. So, little tiny, but you can make the derivative of this stuff. So basically, yeah, you can just take, for example, this one, this one, this one, A, the constant. Then you have E minus Y to the power of 1/2. Then make the derivative. Be careful that I'm not sure how to derive because it's just a passage, but anyway. Remember that here you have y, but you have also a. And remember that if you are asking people, remember a is a function of y. Depending on the space. So when you make the derivative, you have to do that. And you have to be careful because this is multiplied by the square. So in energy, and if you put everything into zero, you obtain this universal law. Why I say universal? Because you see that here you are, the area of the conception, but you don't make any assumption on your conception, which means that you can have a rectangular section, a trapezoidal section, a triangular one, and various ones, so you can, for example, compute some integrals to evaluate your area. And this program that we obtain right here are universal form. The second definition, is the same. So this is root 2 1, we have to root 2. So for 2, of course, it's easy because we have to derive the energy respect to y if I fix the q. So basically, 2 says that I have to derive this e, but this e is easier because the derivative of e over y will be y, the derivative over y is 1, plus, remember that a is depending on y, and a is at the denominator. Then it's like saying this stuff, q to the power of 2 over 2g, that in this case is constant because we assume that q is constant in the second demonstration. So this is the constant times a to the power of minus 2, which in turn comes up to minus 2. Then you have the constant q to the power of 2, q sorry, the power of 2 over 2g times a minus 3. Right? Because when you make the derivative of an exponent, you have to decrease the exponent. Alright, so bye, and you obtain set. Oh, sorry, missed one thing. Because it's a to the power of minus 3, but a is depending on y, so you have also to consider da over b dy. The differential of a over y. So, let's notice that dA over y means this part. So if I make refraction, it gives me back the width of your free surface. Because dA, this part right here, is exactly equal to b times dy. Because dy is this incremental depth on your water. Do you agree? Then if the A is equal to b times dy, meaning will be dA over dy. So basically, this stuff is equal to b. So the width of your free surface. But if it's true, and for the completeness, I have to put everything equals to zero. This is not to be considered. So everything is equal to zero. So in the end, what you obtain is exactly the definition number 2 in the slide. So you obtain your verdict. Depends on what you are looking for. Usually when we will see some example about how to compute the critical depth. We will use this kind of problem. Because in uniform motion, when you have to define the kind of riverbed that you are considering, you have to compare to YC, which is this, and YU, which is the depth associated to the
will need to make the uniform motion.
So, basically, here you see an example for the vertebral case. So, for the vertebral case, for example, if you derive the two equations, you have that the cross section area is A, so it's equal to the base times the height, right? Okay. Then the wet perimeter, capital B, is equal to this part right there, because it's the only part of your open segment in contact with the water. So it will be V0 plus 2 times Y. So if you derive the first one, you get, as I told you yesterday, the slide, I will check it before giving to you, because maybe sometimes some 1, 2 are invented, but the concepts that I'm saying, they are fine, but maybe the slide are not in another way, so I will check better before giving it to you, if it's necessary. Then, let's try how to reach it. So, for example, if I follow number 2, I have A to the power of 3 over B equal to Q to the power of 3 over G. Which means, let's substitute the area of the rectangular section that gives you that. V0, the power of 3 times Y, the power of 3 over V stands for V0, because it's the free surface, the width of the free surface, equal to Q to the power of 2 over V, and I can simplify this one with this, and I can get directly this one, which is not the general depth, but exactly our critical depth, and which is equal to exactly the definition number 2. So basically, the first mistake, as it happens, this one is 2, because of course it's not 1. So they are invertible. So this one is 2, and this one is 1. So I will change it to be more clear, because unfortunately sometimes number goes away. So it's yc squared minus 3 q to the power of 2 over g v0 to the power of 2. And this ratio, which is basically the ratio among our discharge and our width of the free surface, is also called the specific discharge. So sometimes you can find out that instead of this, you can find either Q to the power of 2 over the river bed. If I follow the first definition, I find out B0YC, because we are getting the critical depth, over 2B0 equal to E. So again, this goes away, and you have YC plus YC over 2, that makes 3 over 2 YC equal to the specific depth. So basically, what I would like that remains in your mind is that when you have an element in your problem that remains constant, you use the first condition, which is general, you substitute the shape of the section inside the first condition, and you reach the critical depth associated with the case of energy that remains constant. In the other case, it's usually when you have, for example, constant, so basically your energy can change, and what's happened is that again you substitute into this definition the geometry of your section, right? So after all, you have to remember 1 and 2, and then substitute. Alright, any questions?
it cuts the, okay, anyway. So basically, it is what we said before. Because before we said that if I fix the energy and I relate that with the discharge, I can find a minimum, a maximum value of the discharge, and this divide all the domain in two regions where if y is over yc, I have a slow current. If it's, sorry, it's bigger, let's see. If it's lower, instead, we have a fast current. Again, the same consideration can be done for the diagram of Q constant and the relation among the depth and the energy. So again, all the depth greater than what we see as reminds to slow currents, while all the depth lower than what we see reminds to fast currents. Okay, yes, please.
On the x axis, Q and when y is equal to yc is the at the highest one, and the upper one and the lower one is why Q is decreasing. Why we are seeing at the top Q velocity is slowing, but then the Q at the below that dash line is decreasing here.
Okay.
Why we are seeing it is there. Q should increase.
Exactly.
But why the red line is decreasing?